Welcome to the Istituto Italiano di Cultura. Tonight, the evening is, it's tasty. we have the great pleasure of hosting this evening with Alessandro Marzadro, who is here because he will take part in the Spirits of Toronto on Saturday, which is a fair of spirits, and he will present his own products, and you can see them, you have it on display. It's not cognac, it's not armagnac, it's not brandy, but the color, doesn't really tell you what it is. Usually, we don't identify that color with grappa, but this is actually grappa, a type of spirits which is typically Italian. And we are very happy that Alessandro accepted to come and present us with this evolution in the production of grappa, that is aged grappa, fruitful grappa, or grappa with aromas and different sort of things. I don't know anything about it because I must confess I'm not a drinker of spirits, but I like the color and I like the smell of it. Yeah. So the evening is going to be evolving in this way. First, Alessandro introduces to you in the lecture what they do in their own vineyard or factory or distillery. And then at the end of the lecture, there's a little video. And then we will, you will be invited to taste the grappa accompanied with the food that is in the other room in the library, and which is offered by Paganelli. Gabriele Paganelli is an Italian chef. He is also a person that now is interested in producing his own cured meats. So, the bread, or focaccia, that you're going to taste is made by Gabriele, as well as the salami that you're going to try tonight. So I hope you enjoy this evening. I'm very grateful to Ivo Pinocchi from Grappa Ambassador, who is over there, and his lovely daughter that will help in passing of, in serving the grappa later on, because he suggested doing this cooperation with us. And I'm really interested in doing also these kind of things because I believe that whatever is food and drink is part of the culture of the population. And you will see what it means. It's part of our history. It's part of our life. So we are really interested in exposing you and also us, because we don't know so much about it, to this kind of lectures. So, without further ado, welcome to Toronto, Alessandro, e grazie, and I leave the floor to you.
Yeah, thank you very much. Good evening, everybody. Well, thank you for having us here. Let's say that I don't know how much you know about grappa. We'll try to go through and see all different aspects of the product. So the idea is to give you all the most of the information about the history of the product, where it comes from, what is the different technical that you can have in the production, and the style of product at the end. So that's where we want to go. I'm part of the family Marzadro. It's a third generation company. Most of the distillery started just after the Second World War, like a lot of things happening in Italy. And making spirits in Italy is 90% making grappa. So using what's left after winemaking, skin and seeds. That's what is our raw material. And the production of grappa is really related to mainly the north part of Italy. In America it's different, but in Europe, cold climate means spirit production, okay? That's where you find the spirit production, but in general speaking. We will go through this kind of thing, so history of grappa, what is grappa, type of grappa, and you recognize the quality, how do you recognize the quality, and what is white and aged grappa. So this is a new, let's say, concept in the grappa production. This is our company. We are coming from Trentino. I don't know if you, any of you have been there or you know the area. Trentino is the northeast part of Italy. It's a small region. We have 500,000 people living there, mainly mountains. It's quite famous for the skiing in the winter. That's where we have the Dolomites, so part of the Alps where we have these really high peaks. And that's where the highest number of distilleries are in Italy, because in this region we have 29 distilleries. Out of the real working distillery in Italy now, there are around 50. Okay, so it's a really big area for the number of distilleries, not for the quantity, but we will go through that later on. This is the Italy. You see where we are, where we are located. We are north of Verona, 60 kilometers, and we are 180 kilometers to the Austrian border. So if you drive half an hour from where we live, in that area we also have the bilingual, so people speak German and Italian as well. So that's mainly why we have a big tradition of spirits. The Austrian, when they were there, and the Venetian also made us, let's say, go into the tradition of making spirits. Just to let you know, the spirits production actually has a really, this is quite a strange story, but the distilling system is very old. The name alembic actually comes from the Egyptian. So the distilling system is known since a lot of time. But it was used to make perfumes mainly, okay, not for spirits. The first written traces in more quiet of using distilling system to make spirits actually was in Salerno, which is south of Naples, as you can see in the map here. And in that university, at that time it was the 14th century, we have the first written trace of distilling wine to make a spirit. And funny enough, at that time the nobody was drinking spirit, they used it as a medicine, right? And at that time the Black Plague started to arrive in Sicily, and from there the monks were using spirits as an antiseptic on the skin and to give it to the patients so that they feel a little bit better, so drinking. From the medicine to a drink, probably the road was very short. And from that time, the plague went around all Europe, and this technique went all the way to other places. And the distilling system arrived in Switzerland. Main production was fruit, so they started to make fruit spirits. In the north part of Ireland, there were a lot of Catholics, so they were distilling wine to make spirits. Then this distilling system went down to Scotland, and they had a lot of barley, and that's where whiskey comes from. No? So that's the story of it. Obviously, spirit, wine, and tea. You have to remember that in most of the country, is before a drink, it was clean water. Okay, we drink a lot of wine because it was a clean water at that time. Okay, fermentation will make, and the alcohol will make the product safe. In the Russian way of drinking spirits and the Polish is related to they didn't have wine production, so the spirit was clean water. If you go east, you will find tea. Boiling water with leaves will make the water drinkable. Okay, so that's where it comes from. So the cultural part of the spirits is very important to understand why the spirits are like this. Okay? In this story, we can actually divide the spirits in two big categories. The rich people spirits and the poor people spirits, okay? And it's quite easy to understand by what is the raw material, okay? In Italy, if you ask my grandfather in 1949 to get his good wine and distill it, he would probably, run out of you and say, you're crazy, I will never distill my wine, I drink wine. So that's a poor tradition, that's why we use skin and seeds after winemaking. Using potatoes, same thing. So vodka, the traditional vodka made in Russia and Poland, come from the really poor tradition. Distilling wine, France, so brandy, cognac, armagnac, usually rich tradition. Whiskey, barley. In Italy, with barley, you make soup, you make flour, you make a lot of things, but you don't make spirits. And strangely enough, these rich spirits often are aged. So the aging is also something that you can do if you have the possibility to do it. So buy a barrel and wait time. Okay. Normally the production of grappa was you produce today, you produce enough for the year, and then the next year you have to produce again because you finished it. Okay, that's the idea. So this is where grappa comes from. And this is a picture It's 1945, 49. This is the village where I live. This is my house here, and the back is my parents' house. Just to give you an idea how Italy was. And so, you know, that's not, let's say, a rich environment for sure. So this thing was making some goods from leftovers, and also grappa was seen as a, let's say, energy drink, because the main consumption of grappa was in the morning, from 7 o'clock to 10 o'clock. That was the main consumption of grappa in Italy. Okay, before going inside into the field, cold climate, hard work, you know, you burn everything, so it's okay. And once the consumption of grappa went lower in the 80s, so people started to feel better and they didn't need, you know, to drink spirit before going to work. That's where the tradition of, I don't know if you know it, the caffè corretto, so the coffee with grappa inside. Okay? It was quite funny, but at that time, if you were drinking grappa, also now, but at that time, it started at the beginning. If someone saw you drinking grappa at 8 in the morning, you said, oh, hey, you're a drunken, you know, what are you doing? So putting grappa in the coffee, you look like you're drinking coffee, but really you're drinking grappa. That's where it comes from. This is the thing. So that's why it's very important to understand why grappa, since, let's say, 5 to 10 years ago, has always been, let's say, a medium, low quality product, mainly white, and often made at home, privately, with low quality. The most important thing is how many liters can I get out of it. That was the main important thing. So it's very important to understand it, because that's where it comes from. This is my grandfather. This is the town where I live. It's Rovereto. It's a 40,000 people town. My grandfather, one of my uncle, and the two sisters of my grandmother. And they were going to the town probably once a month with a motorbike. It was 5 minutes away, not very far, but they went once a month. In the village where we were, we had one telephone, and one motorbike. That was the only one. So my grandfather had to take all the people in town. He was kind of a taxi driver as well. So that's the situation. This was the old way of making spirits. We will see later on, this is not a system that we use anymore. I don't know if you've seen distillery or if you know about spirits, but this will be very similar to a double pot still that they used to make spirits. So, whiskey. So a first pot, condenser, then this liquid that you get out, you have to take it, redistill it again. So it's a double distillation process used to make cognac and whiskey. For grappa, they were using this because it was the most simple, but the result is not so good, I would say, you know, comparing to what we use now. This was the assortment, so 4 products to do everything. This was the best seller, white traditional grappa, 43%, that's it. Then you had people starting to get tired to that taste, so we started to put plants inside. So with the plant, you put it there in 3 weeks, the grappa will take out the color and the taste, so it will change a little bit the taste. And this was an example of aged grappa, even though the aging of grappa was made with a different philosophy, okay? The main consumption was white, so in the aging room, you will put only the bad stuff. That was the concept at that time, okay? If it's a good grappa, we keep it white. If it's not good, let's put it into wood and hope it gets better. It's important to understand where we come from, first of all, to appreciate what we did as well. Family business, see, this is my father, my uncle, two auntie, and the third generation, so me, my brother, and 2 cousins. And we are also taking over the company, and we have 60 employees, so it's a medium-sized company. And we could say that we are inside the first 10 distillery in Italy. Thinking that inside the 70, let's say 50 real distillery that we have on now in Italy, 2 of them make 60% of the national grappa, okay? So these 2 guys make grappa for the wine producer, they make a lot of grappa for other company, and so 1 bottle on 2 will contain that kind of product. And is usually made with an industrial system. We will go through that so that you can understand what is the difference. And so, let's say the artisanal grappa in Italy is not so much, okay, let's say half of what is on the market. And that's important also to understand good and bad quality products. Well, what is grappa? What is grappa? Grappa, I don't know if you, every one of you knows it. Sometimes if you ask to a non-Italian, they said, oh yes, it's a Greek product, they make it also in Hungary. Well, grappa is just a name for an Italian spirit. So if you see the word grappa, this product should be made in Italy from Italian mark. Mark is the actual name of skin and seeds of the grapes. The only thing that you can add is maximum 2% of white sugar. And the percentage should be from 37.5 to 60 percent. If any of these rules are not respected, you cannot write grappa on top. Okay, so that's the regulation. In our region, we also have because we have a lot of producer, we made a regulation which is a little bit more strict for the days of production and a lot of rules that we have to follow. But the national rules is this. This is our distillery. So we go through the different kinds. Let's say that in worldwide we have three main different distilling systems. Okay, you have the whiskey one, which is a double pot still. So a pot, a condenser, and then you redistill it another time. It's used for whiskey, bourbon, cognac. Then you have this single distillation system. So you have a pot, a column, and then a condenser. So in one go, this goes through the first distillation, then you have the concentration, and then the condensation. So you don't distill it twice, you distill it just in one. This distilling system is used to make grappa, traditional grappa. Then you have the fruit spirits, all the fruit spirits, Switzerland, Austria. Also, some gin producers are starting to use this kind of system, some small whiskey producer as well, and Armagnac. So, if you want to understand the difference between a double pot still and a single distillation system, compare Armagnac and Cognac. The main difference you feel there is given by the distilling system. Double pot still usually gives you more, the less taste. So, Cognac usually you feel much more the wood. If you drink Armagnac, you feel much more the spirit, okay? Because the single distillation tends to give you more taste out. Okay? The third system, which is the industrial way, it can be used also to make grappa, it's called continuous system, and is the one that is used to make vodka, rum, the Spanish rum, let's say, Spanish island rum, and also grappa. This is a system that the aim is to neutralize the spirit, okay? So in vodka, they will tell you that the quality of vodka is related to how many times they distill it. Okay, if you distill a lot of time, you will take a lot of the taste out. Okay, if you're looking for a neutral spirit, that's okay. If you do that with grappa, it's probably no point. Okay, you will lose the taste, and I would say buying vodka is cheaper and it's better. That doesn't make sense. When do we have to do that? When the raw material is not fresh, you will have to distill it in a continuous system, because you're cleaning the taste out. Okay? Similar to the process, I don't know if you know the process of olive oil. You have extra virgin olive oil and normal olive oil. Okay? Extra virgin olive oil is made by squeezing the olives with a normal temperature, and that's the oil comes out, that's okay. The normal olive oil without extra virgin is usually done, and then it's distilled. Okay? So with the distillation, you take out all the taste. It's oily, you feel the fat part of the oil, but you lose everything. So if you don't have good olives, you will have to do that. But you will not have the complexity, the taste, and all this kind of thing. So it's similar process. One of the things is the raw material. The raw material is 90% of the quality of the product is related to the raw material. Just to explain why. This stuff here is the skin and seeds, you see, red variety, white variety. It's got 4 to 6% of alcohol inside, okay, so very little. It's very difficult to conserve, and if you're not able to conserve it well, what happens? You have rotting going on, and the wine part will go in vinegar, and if you distill that, you will have a really nice concentration of bad taste. And that's what that was the main problem in grappa. And I always say that a bad whiskey you can still drink it. A bad draft is really something undrinkable because the taste is bad, it burns, it's not pleasant. So that's what most of the people had as an experience. So that's why we're here to try to let try something different. That's the concept. And so the quality in grappa is that you either have a neutral grappa where you don't actually feel much. So I would say it's better a neutral grappa than a bad taste one. And then the high quality grappa where you can actually feel the taste but you don't have bad flavors and it doesn't burn. So when you put a grappa in your nose, you should feel the fruitiness. Going from the fruity to the green, let's say green side, peppers, green grass, but not over. If you feel mushroom cheese, that's something wrong with the aromatic. Yeah. It's like an apple. I mean, if you open an apple, you leave it on the table. After 1 hour, the apple will be black. And you smell it, you will not feel the apple anymore. You will feel something which is not really nice. And so this is fruit and we have to deal with it. And so how do you do that? We have to distill first of all in a certain time of the year. Whiskey distillery will open and will distill probably 10 months a year. Two months they will just close because it's Christmas and they have to repair the machines. The distillation of grappa, if you want to make a good product, you have to, well, the collecting time is just 1 month. So mid-September, mid-October, you have all the marking in the distillery. And then you can decide to collect a lot and distill until March, April, May, or you can decide to collect less and distill it quickly. So we work 100 days, night and day, Saturday and Sunday. So more or less at the end of November we finished. Okay, that well, depends on the season. Sometimes it's later, sometimes a little bit earlier. In our region, all the 29 producers actually signed this regulation that we have to turn our distillery off before Christmas. Okay, this is the first guarantee that you have that at least you're not distilling stuff after 6 months. Okay. And after that, you need to store them in stainless steel tanks, control the temperature, take out the oxygen. So it's quite a complicated process, but it's really, really fundamental to have, let's say, a pleasant, elegant and nice spirit. Okay, so another thing that we I don't know if everyone knows, but in the past grappa was just a general thing. You know, do you want a grappa? Is it digestive? Well, by the way, it's not a digestive, okay? It doesn't make you digest. It's a spirit, so it's so difficult to digest that the alcohol goes in your blood. So if you need to digest, I would say go to the doctor, not to the distillery. It is a spirit, so it opens up a little bit your blood vessel, but it doesn't mean that it doesn't make you digest. So if you drink a grappa, you have to look for it, and you will have to enjoy it, drink it slowly, and don't just drink it because you need to digest. That's one of the I ask you that. So inside the grappa, we have actually is a category. So inside we have differences. Okay, that's important because. A white variety grappa, so white grape grappa, it's totally different from a red grape grappa. Okay? So often when we choose a grappa, we think like with the wine. Okay, so I like, let's say, Amarone grappa, I like the Amarone wine, I will drink the Amarone grappa. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. Okay. Funny enough, most of the time, you find around is a red variety grappa because the important wines are red and so they're using the red variety grappa. But a red variety grappa is, let's say, the most traditional product, so it's very dry, it's a long aftertaste. And I would say, if you want to start to learn and understand grappa, it's not a good starting point. Okay, it's like if someone introduce you to whiskey and they suggest you to drink a really strong peated whiskey at the beginning, you probably will, well, for sure, you will not like it. For sure, and if you're if you're not open-minded, you say, okay, I don't like whiskey, and that's closed, and you finished your experience. Yeah? So I would say that the red variety are dry and long aftertaste, so they feel a little bit stronger than the white variety. White variety will give you more fruity notes, and the aftertaste is shorter. Aromatic variety usually are there are not many in the variety that we can consider aromatic. One is Moscato, the other one is Gewürztraminer. And the Malvasia is also aromatic. Aromatic means that when you distill this variety, you will get a really strong flowery, fruity note coming out. Okay? We will try one of these today so that you can understand what is the difference. These ones are quite interesting because if you like the wine where they come from, you get the primary aromas coming out. So in the Gewürztraminer Grappa, if you know the Gewürztraminer wine, you can create a straight connection. In the other varieties, it's not so easy or so clear. These three categories, then, they can be aged. So, differently from whiskey distillers usually start from white spirits, and then they age it in different ways, and they get out end products or whatever. With grappa, you have three categories of product that can be aged, so the variety and the type of product you can get at the end is much, much bigger. Because aging a Gewürztraminer is different from aging a Cabernet or Merlot harvest. Totally different way of doing it. And the aging, as we said, is something quite new. We were one of the first companies, actually, in 1998, to start to buy new barrels to do this test. And we didn't know how to do it. So you say, okay, you don't know how to do it, you see what the other guys are doing and you try to learn. The only way is to buy barrels, different size, different wood, different level of toasting, and put the grappa inside. And that's how you can understand how this product is how this barrel works. And from there, we put the grappa inside, and we waited a little bit, and we start to see where the grappa was going. The age doesn't tell you the quality of the product, okay? So, don't think that older means better. Older for sure means more expensive, doesn't mean better though. Okay? Especially when we're talking about the grappa, the traditional grappa, where you can actually feel the taste of the grappa. If I make a product, a grappa, which doesn't taste like grappa, probably I made a mistake. Okay, so we have to always, in our point of view, to keep the balance between the wood and the taste of grappa. So what happened when you put a grappa in a barrel, you will have the taste of grappa starting from high, and while the time goes on, the taste of grappa will go down, because evaporation will make you lose the taste of grappa. And at the same time, the taste of wood starts from low and increase. Okay? So it's like a recipe. You have two ingredients, you need to balance them. If you don't balance them, you have or a product which is too woody or a product which is not wood enough. That's very important. So aging has to be done in a certain way. We don't want to ruin the product. And today we'll try two products that try to explain this concept. Okay, and it doesn't mean the age is not the thing that changed. Because if I ask you, I usually do this thing. Which one is the older one? The oldest. Sorry. This one. This one? Well, you can't actually tell, okay? But I would say this one is 3 years old, this is 18 months, okay? So the color only tells you how much wood intensity you will feel inside the product, okay? But not the age. Because this product here stays 3 years in 1,000 liter barrel, this one stays 18 months mainly in 225 liter barrels. So a smaller barrel will give you more color and more taste. What we can say that in here you have strong wood coming in and you're not losing a lot of the taste of grappa, so it should be balanced. In this case we're using a bigger barrel, but in this case we have one single variety, so we don't want to cover the taste of the grappa too much. So we want to be a little more delicate. So it's a game, and each company, each distiller decides a little bit what he wants to do and how he wants to do it. I will not say there is a rule, there's no rules. Just try, and what you like, you do. The last category is aromatized. So if we start from a white grappa and we add something, it will be something based with grappa. We will try a chamomile grappa. So from a white grappa, we put inside chamomile flowers, like making a big tea. We leave it there for 21 days. After that, we take out these cotton bags, and the grappa is taken out the color, the taste, and we add a little bit of water and sugar. So is a liqueur based with grappa, but it can be called aromatized grappa. Tasting terms, okay, when you try grappa, well, here there are different point of view. I will give you my my idea. Let's say that technically a product can be good or not good. Technically good or not good. So it can be a good spirit or not well done spirit. After that is matter of taste. Each one of us has a different taste and we have to respect that, okay? I can give you the idea of where the type of aromas you're feeling goes, if it's more green, more fruity, more flowery, but I'll usually, in my tasting, I never go on saying, you know, this is the strange flower that you can find on a small island on the top of Europe that, you know, nobody knows it. So there's no point of having, from my point of view, having this approach to the tasting. But for sure, what is pleasant to the nose is something, it means it's good. What is not pleasant is not good. You know, we have to go back to the, let's say, the nature, you know, same thing. Good taste and bad taste. I would say that the fruitiness, the aroma has to be from the fruitiness to the let's say, green and peppery nose. The flower should be, the taste in the product should be in the tongue. You shouldn't have burning down the throat. That should be the characteristic. If we have to say about the defect of grappa, and we said off flavor, overripened fruit, mushrooms, cheese, these kind of things, then one thing that often unfortunately happens is to drink something that feels a little bit like chemical, burnt rubber. That's a problem of distillation. And then sometimes you get some products which have this strong reminder of nail polish. That also is a problem of distillation. So, as I said, you know, if you are lucky to get a bad grappa, you have a lot of things that really are not really, really nice. So this is what we have to avoid, and you will feel it straight away. You don't need to be an expert. If you feel this kind of things in the glass, it's simple. It's not good. Well, the temperature of serving. This is another thing which is sometimes quite funny. If they come out with a bottle which got like that ice on the side, I mean, any grappa is good at that temperature. Okay, anything is good. Okay, but drinking a grappa from the freezer is like drinking a really important red wine from the freezer. You drink it, but you don't feel anything. So I go back to vodka. I said, buy vodka, it's cheaper if you have to drink it that way. It was something that in the past was done a lot, because if you don't have a good quality grappa, just put it in the freezer and, you know, it's okay. You don't drink it, you don't feel anything. So that's the point. I would say that generally speaking, 17 to 20 degrees is the normal temperature, depending on where you are. I don't think you have that problem in Canada, but in the really warm areas, like I would say south of Italy, in the summer it's better to keep it down to 10 maximum, 10 minimum and 15. So that you feel a little bit of freshness in the mouth. And anyway, it gets heats up very quickly. Well, this is quite nice as well. This is an old way of tasting the grappa. You can do it on your hand or you can do it on your glass, it's the same thing. But what happens if you put a liquid on your skin or you leave a little bit in the glass, after a while the alcohol will evaporate, and if you smell it, you will feel the actual taste of the product. Because the difficult part, if you're not used to drinking spirits, is that you have the alcohol and ethanol, which is the transporter of the taste. Okay, so you need to divide what is ethanol and what is the taste. There's no rubber. We said that, all that. And another thing about the aging room is the way of aging really change also the cost of the product, because using old barrel is one thing, using new barrel is totally different. I mean, the if I buy an old barrel, I will invest more or less 50 euros, so let's say it's $80. If I buy a new barrel, I will invest $800, okay? Just to give you an idea. Obviously, you will get a result in a shorter time, but it's a totally different way of working. Just to give you an idea, in our aging room we have 2,000 to 2,500 barrels, and every year you change 200, the big one and the small. And we have 10 different suppliers, because also in the making of the barrels, I don't know if you know how they make the barrels, but each barrel producer gives a different taste. So we work with 10 different suppliers.
different toasting, different kind of wood, different size, and that's how you can have, a spectrum of different products, because each barrel is different, that can be mixed together to make a better balanced and taste product.
Alessandro, I think you have a question.
Do we have a question?
Are they French barrels?
Yeah. All of them are, they come in new. We don't buy them from a wine producer like Port, Sherry, this kind of thing.
Okay.
We are doing a test. We have in the warehouse three port casks. But we have some problems with the regulation, because actually it's seen as putting aromas in the grappa doing this kind of process.
Okay.
But we're doing it anyway. We'll probably not sell it, but we're doing it anyway, just to see how it goes. And if it's good, we'll probably fight to have it.
Mm-hmm. I think she asked for the French, not French.
Oh, fresh or French?
Oh, is it French?
French.
Yes.
Yeah, okay. No, with 10 suppliers, we have some from France, some from Hungary, some come from Italy, some come from Romania, it depends. Okay. The French oak is very famous, but I think it's also nearly finished. Okay.
Yeah.
So also the French barrels sometimes are made from Romanian wood, Hungarian wood. They have the knowledge and the technique how to make it. Don't think that it's just the wood where it comes from, the important thing. It's mainly the toasting and the type. But the same variety of oak that grows in France, you find it in Romania. It's the technique how to make it. The only wood that is really different is the American oak. It tastes different. Okay. So it gives you different notes in your product. Well, this is one of the products. We will go through this later with the tasting. But the first product we will try is called the Chotolun. It's our first aged spirit. 18 months distilled in aged in different kind of barrels, different wood and different size. After the 18 months, the same grappa, we take it out from the barrels and we blend it together. We mix it together. We start from a mixed variety grappa, because there is a single variety, but the mixed variety is probably, if you want to make a balanced product, is the best way of doing it. Because you give the structure of the red variety, but you give the perfumes of the white, and so you have, at the end, the most balanced product. These are some words. The grappa is starting, especially in Europe, to have some recognition also in the international tastings, like the International Wine Spirit Competition in London. So that's positive. I think we are doing, now we bring good products, so it's worth it to go out and, you know, let people know this. The second one we will try will be the Illustraminer. The Illustraminer is a white variety. The most famous wine is the French one, Alsace. But the Illustraminer variety is also grown in Trentino, Alto Adige, where we are. That's the only region in Italy. And in Austria and Germany, you can find this variety. Gewürz means aromatic in German. This is aged 36 months in 1,000 liters. So here we will feel much less wood. And that's what we do in purpose, because if we write Gewürztraminer on the bottle, I want to feel the Gewürztraminer. I don't want to cover it with wood. Okay, so that's the one. Also, here's some recognition. And the third one is, you know, it's like a game, but it's starting from a white grappa. We make an infusion of chamomile for 21 to 30 days, 35%, so it's sweet and lighter. But it's good if you want to be introduced of grappa, you have this aftertaste, and it helps to understand a little bit better the well, you know, the grappa has a long story, and we have a lot of countries where a lot of Italians went there and they took the grappa with them, but they took with them the grappa that was produced in the 50s and 60s. So a lot of Italians, they have that picture of grappa, but grappa has changed, and we want to let people know it and let it try. So it will probably take a bit long, but we want to do that, and then that's what we're going to do. Do you have any question? We're here, so we have time, and it's no problem, but yes.
In your slide, you talked about the different temperatures. What was the 10 to 15?
Well, 10 to 15, it's think about a holiday in Sicily in August, June, be 35, 40 degrees, and you want to have a grappa, I would suggest you to have it a little bit colder. So keep it at 10 to 15 degrees. Then by the time you serve in the glass, you take it outside, the temperature has gone up, but you're not drinking grappa at 40 degrees, because 40 degrees is kind of soup temperature, it's not grappa.
So that's not the drinking temperature, but the serving temperature.
Yes, serving.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Starting with skins and seeds.
Yep.
And then you're fermenting it.
Yep.
Again. And what is the yeast? You know, when you're making wine, it's the sugar in the grape that the yeast is. So the sugar has already been consumed by the yeast. So what is the yeast
burning?
Yeah. Make all this.
We have to make a separation from the white to the red variety. Okay. You know that red wine is made, it becomes red because the skins, they stay in the wine, okay? If you squeeze a red grape variety, you will have a white wine, okay, if you don't leave the skins there. So the red variety skins, they will stay with the wine, so they will ferment with the wine, and so we will receive them already fermented, okay? The white variety, most of the wine, they don't, the grape, the skins don't stay with the wine, so they collect the grape, they squeeze it, the liquid goes on one side, the solid goes on the other side. So we receive the skins with sugar inside. 4%, it's not a lot.
Right.
So there we have yeast and that we have a fermentation. 4 to 6 days we will transform the sugar in alcohol. It's a forced fermentation, so we add wine yeast to it because it's not enough to have a spontaneous fermentation.
And what's left at the end of that?
The distillation?
Yeah.
Well, after distillation, you will have still skin and seeds. These skins don't have alcohol anymore. Mm-hmm. What we do is that we have company coming there and buy them. Well, take them away, but they don't buy it, but they just take them away for free. They make oil from the seeds, the grape seeds. They extract tartaric acid from the skin as well. Sometimes they use it to burn it to make energy. So it's being reused. I mean, the Italian culture, the Italian gastronomic culture is all really related to reuse something. Most of the most important recipes related to reuse some things, you know, like the salumi. I mean, if you look at our cured meat, it's just, you kill the pig today and you need to do 10 different preparations so that you have meat for all the year. That's why we have different shape and different style of cured meat, because it's something that we needed to do at that time.
Do you guys make white
grappa? Yes, we do.
Oh.
Yeah, we do. Well, obviously, you have to, because when to make it age, first of all, it's white. You know, after the distilling system, we do also make white grappa. But what we're trying to use in the export market is mainly the age one.
Oh.
Because if you want to change people's mind, the color helps a lot. Okay. Because if I have the, you know, if I see an aged product, I'm more open to retry it if I had a bad experience. Also, I mean, just to give you an idea, we had the same problem in Italy because the grappa consumption is made. It was mainly in the north, Rome, Naples, Sicily. They were not drinking grappa at all, and they started to drink grappa with the aged product. Okay, because it was something smoother, something that they understand more. Now they probably drink more grappa than we do in the north. So it's changed totally. And now, after 15 years of this kind of trend, they are starting to understand and to ask the white grappa. Okay, so you need to drive your way through there. Starting with the white grappa is not very simple, I would say, because it's not an easy spirit.
The grappa distilleries, did you say there were?
Okay, I'll give you the data then, so the full data. We have 125 companies in Italy who are mainly selling grappa. Out of these 125, 76 have real distilling system, so they produce. Well, they have a distilling system. The producing one are around 50, 45 to 50. Okay, two of these make 60% of the grappa. And in Trentino we have plenty of that. So we see a lot of labels, a lot of brands, but really who's making the grappa, there are not many people, more many companies, unfortunately. We're losing a little bit of the tradition.
So 48 real artisanal type of...
Well, no, real distillery. Inside this 48 you have these two as well, which are very big and they make a lot of grappa, industrial grappa.
Okay.
but, you know, people make Grappa here in Canada, but but nobody's doing it on a commercial scale.
Yes, exactly.
Here in
also in Trentino we have family.
Actually there is someone here, but not necessarily before, but even after, it's not a digestive, really more for enjoyment.
That's what we try to explain, because if we sell it as a digestive, you know, initially digestive, you drink it with a coffee, with the time of the coffee, you know, because here the coffee you drink is slow. In Italy it's like 35 seconds to drink a coffee. And if you drink a grappa like that, it's not pleasant. But if it's like if you drink a strong peated whiskey like that, you know, even though you're a big fan of peat, you know, it would be heavy. You know?
Okay.
So you need to take it slow and appreciate the product. Yeah.
Okay, it's interesting to learn that, because I think it seems that that's the conception, that it is, you know, offered as a digestive, and if that's not really what it is, it's
because if it's not a good product, you need to find a way, why should I drink it? Because it's a digestive.
Yeah.
But, you know, I would be happy if you drink it because you like it, not because it's a digestive.
Yeah.
That's the point.
Yeah, thank you.
And so this is the idea that we're trying to develop.
But we used to have it, like, it'd be dinner,
yeah,
and then out would come the espresso pot and the grappa.
Yes.
And then you'd have the espresso, throw the grappa inside, and then, you know, you'd always, like, drink a little bit too, right?
Well, what happened in Italy, for all the situations, especially on the food thing, if you go to someone, everyone will tell you, this is the real way how to do it. Everyone. And if you go to four people, you have four different styles. I'm very confused. In Italy, there is no real way of doing this. Recipe. It doesn't exist one recipe. If you go to five, you know, grandmothers, they will give you five different recipes. And all of them will tell you, this is the real way. It's very funny. I mean, in our recipe, we have a sign which is called QB. Okay, it means quanto basta. Okay, as much as needed.
Right.
If you need to know the quantity, as much as needed is not quantity. But this is where we come from. This is the way of making things. So you don't find the rule in things. You know? Every areas, because of historical reason or different way of making, they have this. But we don't have, compared to the French cuisine has a code. The French cuisine comes from Paris. And they have written everything. Italian cuisine comes from everywhere, right? So it doesn't, you know, you don't have a code on that.
But I think it's true that if you had a bag, like I remember the grappa we got wasn't my own, my portnoy passed away, so it was bought from the store, and it was good grappa, right? So I have good memories of grappa, right? But I think if you have, you do give it that jet fuel connotation of like, you know, burning you, and you know.
And this feeling is often coming from the house-made grappa, because it's not easy to make the grappa. Really, it's not easy. And it's also a little bit dangerous, but it's not easy to make a good one.
Like in Canada, we have this thing called screech.
Screech?
Okay. Yeah, it's called screech, and it's a homemade liquor, and it would be white also, right? You know, when you think of white liquor, there's a connotation of it coming out of somebody's backyard or the woods somewhere, or, you know.
And that's why we're concentrating more on the age
problem, the
because
color.
This kind of feeling is not... It's not what we want to you know, have in our product. But if you think about also what's happening in the US with the moonshine,
the moonshine
is kind of having a new life now, because they're making it more neutral, more elegant, and so it's coming back. And so, I mean, if you were going to the US 10 years ago and they would compare your product to moonshine, you would get angry.
Yes.
Now, if they do it, not so much. So it's changing. And people are getting into spirits in a different way. I mean, today, the reason for not drinking the spirits are so many that, you know, I'm driving, it's cost, it's very expensive. You know, the reason are so many that if I do drink the spirits, it's because something is in the back. I know what I'm drinking. I want to have an experience. That's why it can't be just a digestive.
I don't know if you have converted me, but seriously, I will give it a try.
Can I please fill those last two? It looks sad.
non è che svalicate meglio di vecchiate, è un tipo di contenitore, però si può.
Thank you. I've seen it.
I'll remember your face.
This is the first one, yeah. So it's a mixed variety grappa. So 70% of red variety and 30% of white.
Right.
So as a white spirit, and then we put in four different kind of barrels: oak, cherry wood, acacia, ash, and then mix it up after
the. I want to ask you about the wood thing, because it sounds like it's just oak for some reason.
Well, they say that if I have to choose one wood, only one, I would get oak, because it's balanced between taste and
whatever. But what if you use maple?
Yeah,
like a hardwood, you know, like
ash. I would not say alone. Because, for example, ash and cherry, and the nose are very, very interesting. You get this really interesting note. But in the mouth, they don't give you the structure, the cocoa, vanilla note, and so they are interesting. But for an aged spirit drinker, it feels a bit like unbalanced, I would say.
Okay. This is whiskey. You drink whiskey. Does this taste like whiskey more?
Well, the wood could remind me. I would say it reminds a little bit more bourbon because of the freshness of wood. Usually whiskey is less woody. You get this more, a little bit more drier
taste. Not whiskey. It's not.
You have the aftertaste of resin, kind of taste.
Very kind of coconut, but. You say cocoa, like
cocoa. No, no, cocoa. You get the cocoa of beans, you know. And
there's also grapes that I see on grappas that don't come from Veneto region. They come from Piedmont.
Yeah, Barolo, Nebbiolo, Barbaresco, Barbera. All these are coming from Piedmont.
So you import those much?
No, we distill only variety that we have in our region.
Right.
Okay. But yes, if you
other people.
Yes. Exactly.
It's kind of weird that there's grappa, right?
Well, potentially yes.
I realize it's not technically Italian, but you could, in Spain or in France or in anywhere, we have wine producing. You could call it something else.
It's called Marc de Champagne.
What's it called?
Marc de Champagne is the name of the grappa made with champagne.
Oh, okay.
Champagne
leftover. Champagne is a couple
Right. Well, champagne is a type of wine.
Right.
Region and a type of wine.
He takes his mask, gives it to a distiller, he makes a form, and it gives him back his grappa, right? The industrial guys don't, the wrong word is they don't care where they get their stuff from, because they put a tarp over it so that it kind of eliminates the air on it, and then they use it during the year to do it continuously. But it's not poly and it's not Nonino. It's what you're saying is some of the other brand names we out there is look at it and say, who's this? They don't really have a distillery, it's the commercial guy, it's the continuous ones that are making it, right? And they're basically infusing it.
Innovators.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So but you,
this is the Totolone,
it's the first one.
Which is the one that's got the blend of four different casks.
Okay.
So it's going to be a very, I guess, as was described, like a Peter Scott and all that cloud too, so definitely more of a white taste.
Il segreto di fare le buone grappe è la prima cosa, la vinaccia buona, che sia sana, che non ti abbia odori da bufa, da silos, da aceto. Distillarla fresca e piano piano.
The history of the Marzadro distillery began in 1949 at Brancolino di Nogaredo, a small town in the heart of the Vallegarina in Trentino.
La prima distilleria è nata qua. Avevo tre locali, un piccolo, piccolo.
Without Attilio's sister Sabina, none of this would have been possible.
Resta la mia fortuna, una gran lavoratrice.
Attilio's wife Teresa was also a vital help back in those days.
Quando aveva tempo veniva anche lei a darmi una mano, bottigliare o far pulizia.
From an early age, Attilio and Teresa Marzadro's children also helped out in the family distillery.
Stai abituai con quel badile, la forca in mano, sempre aiutarmi.
In those days, almost all families made wine, and the leftover marc became a precious raw material for making grappa.
C'era la fila, 10-15 carichi.
The first customers started coming, together with the wagons brimming with marc. But there were more than 15 distilleries in the area, and the only way to compete was to make better grappa at a lower price.
le persone che chiedevano una grappa, noi gli domandavamo una grappa, dammi una Marzadro.
In such a short time, the impossible had happened. Never before had a little glass of grappa had a name. Over the years, a close relationship with the Vallegarina has been key for the Marzadro family. This is a corner of Trentino, an area with fascinating contrasts in landscape and climate, from the nearby Lake Garda to the snowy peaks, evocative memories guarded in the Castel Bezzeno and the ongoing commitment to culture of the Mart, the Museum of Contemporary Art in Rovereto. But art is also expressed in a passion for the vine. From the valley to the hills, the Vallegarina is a land of great wines. The greatest of all is Marzamino, the ideal habitat of which is Isera. The virtues of this wine were even praised by Mozart in his Don Giovanni. The passion and skill of the distiller's art is written in this land.
Negli anni Ottanta siamo entrati noi figli a fianco ai genitori nella gestione della distilleria. Sono stati anni molto difficili. C'era la crisi della grappa. La grappa era vista dal mercato come prodotto povero, prodotto da contadini, prodotto rude, difficile da consumare. Questo per noi è stato un banco di prova molto, molto impegnativo, che alla lunga si è dimostrato anche importante perché ci ha insegnato a lavorare e a lavorare sodo.
Fresh ideas were needed. The Marzadro children had the brilliant idea of creating something that reconciled the new tastes of the market with Trentino tradition.
La prima vera grappa che segnò la riscossa fu quella di Marzamino. Grazie alla qualità delle vinacce e alla vicinanza dei produttori alla distilleria, quelle prime bottiglie segnarono un'epoca.
Another product heralding the rebirth of the Marzadro brand in the 80s was grappa with blueberries, another successful combination of innovation and tradition.
E sicuramente in quelle prime buonissime bottiglie con dentro i mirtilli interi abbiamo trovato questa bella alternativa per gusti più moderni, per gusti nuovi e richieste diverse.
This perceptiveness helped Marzadro overcome the difficult 80s and assert itself as a modern business capable of evolving and growing.
Siamo arrivati dopo 55 anni a fare una costruzione che non vi facevo neanche l'idea.
The new Marzadro family home, inaugurated in 2005, is a masterpiece of architecture and style. With a magnificent hanging garden on the roof and using wood and typical Trentino stone, the building blends perfectly into the surrounding landscape.
In più di costruire un impianto di distillazione tipico e rigorosamente artigianale.
This new building is more than just a bigger distillery. It is also designed with the many aficionados of Marzadro products in mind. In the tasting rooms, visitors can try numerous blended and single variety grappas and fruit liqueurs, accompanied by culinary specialities of the Trentino area. There is also a shop offering the entire range of Marzadro products. The gift packs, which include beautiful hand-decorated bottles, are stylish, sophisticated, and unique. But the true heart of the new distillery is the still room, surrounded by a magnificent glass dome. It is here that fresh marc is distilled in copper stills. The best period to visit the distillery is between September and December, when the stills are in use and the new grappa is being born. But what exactly is grappa? It is a spirit distilled from marc, the skins and stems left over from grape pressing. Many factors contribute to the purity of Trentino grappa: the area's wine-growing heritage, the land's unique exposure to the sun, and the marked differences between daytime and nighttime temperatures during the grape ripening period. The results are varieties blessed with acidity and bouquet. The marc is then transformed into grappa by distillation. To make a superior quality grappa, the production cycle must be carried out with care, passion, and skill. 100 days of intense, around-the-clock work. Every day between September and December, over 40 tons of marc from the finest native Trentino varieties is distilled every day. The marc arrives still dripping with must to preserve its precious aromas and flavors. The raw materials are personally selected by Andrea Marzadro.
Il processo di distillazione avviene con un alambicco discontinuo a bagnomaria, tipico del Trentino. L'alambicco è costituito da una caldaia a doppia intercapedine, nella quale vi è acqua calda che riscalda la parete interna. Nella parte interna vi è la vinaccia, la quale si riscalda piano piano fino ad arrivare a una temperatura di 90-92 gradi. A questa temperatura l'alcol vaporizza e passa dalla caldaia alla colonna di rettifica. Qui vi sono i piatti di concentrazione, dove i vapori si concentrano sempre di più fino ad arrivare a una gradazione alcolica di 85-90 gradi. Successivamente i vapori alcolici passano ai condensatori, dove avviene il passaggio dallo stato gassoso allo stato liquido.
During the following stages, the master distiller plays a vital role, deciding when to cut the head and tail. Now only the heart, the purest and most sought-after portion, remains. The master distiller also oversees the stabilization and transformation of the product, assesses the aroma of the grappas, and is responsible for maturing and aging in barrels, where wood and grappa come together and evolve to create the flavors, bouquet, and unmistakable character of Marzadro products. The production cycle ends with bottling, and Marzadro grappa is now ready to be enjoyed.
Adesso farò una grappa che io l'assaggio due o tre volte al giorno, vado a metterla sulle labbra, ma la è proprio profumata, buona, buona.
The latest addition to the range of grappas is Marzadro 43 degrees, an honest, elegant grappa in keeping with Marzadro traditions. While only 4 years old, it's already a classic. 18 Lune by Marzadro, an original project based on a wealth of experience gained over the years.
Le grappe invecchiate hanno sempre fatto parte della nostra filosofia produttiva e le 18 Lune è stata la nostra scommessa vincente in un mercato che alla fine degli anni 90 mostrava interesse solo per le grappe giovani.
To develop its distinctive full flavor and delicate aroma, 18 Lune is aged for over 18 months in small barrels of four different woods: oak, acacia, cherry, and ash, to bring out the best of both the wood and the grappa.
Il blend finale racchiude un profumo etereo dal gusto rotondo con sentori di vaniglia.
Then there are the classic grappas and the single variety selections, or grappas with hand-picked herbs placed still fresh in the bottle. The liqueurs by the Marzadro distillery are distinctively fresh and elegant in flavor, such as anima nera and the many other fruit liqueurs, delicate tributes to the area's typical produce and the tastes of the forest. This is a company that has remained a strictly family concern, and now three generations work together with the same enthusiasm and passion which, almost 60 years ago, inspired Sabina and Attilio Marzadro to embark upon this fascinating adventure.